things that I've learned lately. Meet the young Ismar David. He was born in 1910 in Germany to a Jewish family that was very much involved in the local community, doing his intellectual and cultural activities. So they were a religious family and they practiced the Jewish law. And at the same time, they were very connected with the German culture. In 1928, Ismar moves to Berlin. You can see him here in the picture. And he studies at the University of the Arts. And he studies there from the finest book craftsman of that time. And it is there when he first learns the importance of understanding the culture and the tradition of letter forms used in writing. In 1932, he enters and wins a design competition for the Jewish National Fund. This is a fund that invests in the development of Israel, and every year they publish a book for the donors. So Ismar's design for the cover gets chosen, and he takes up this opportunity to travel to Jerusalem and supervise the printing of his work. And meanwhile in Germany, the Nazi party rises to power, and so Ismar stays for the following 2 decades. There is in Jerusalem, in this pipe. In 1953, he immigrates to New York City to continue his career, and it is quite a prolific one. He masters a variety of media during the course of his very long career, and I'm just going to very quickly scroll through. This was a very challenging task to choose from the many wonderful works that he has. So calligraphy, lettering, book illustration, book covers, a lot of bilingual typographic work, and also architectural design. This is Parkland Memorial in Long Island. He designed the whole Memorial Park, and the Brotherhood Synagogue here in the city. And all of his work is unique and executed to the finest degree. And being a designer and a New Yorker, of course, he's a member of the Type Directors Club. But he was twice a member of this club, and this is a mystery that I just discovered. So you can see 2 certificates, one from 1968 and one from 1978. I found both of them in at the Carey Collection in Rochester when I just spent the month there researching, and like many other things, this is another mystery that I hope I'll somehow get to discover what happened there. And on top of being this prolific designer and artist, Ismar David is also a teacher. He teaches Latin calligraphy at Cooper Union and Pratt, and he also holds a Hebrew workshop. And this is a sketch for a sign he designed for his Hebrew lecture and workshop. And in 1979, he compiles all of his well-tested teaching materials and his learned views of the historical, aesthetic, and technical aspects of the Latin alphabet into this wonderful book called Our Calligraphic Heritage. It has both quite an informative booklet and a series of charts with clean renderings of historical alphabets that are very easy to actually practice with. And in 1990, he produces the Hebrew version of this, and it's called the Hebrew Letter Calligraphic Variations, and in it not only he covers the historical Hebrew writing, but he also offers new options in those charts, which is just fascinating to look at. And if anyone is interested in learning about Hebrew, I personally recommend this this kit. It's very good. So let me take you back to Jerusalem in the early 30s, when Ismar David settles in the German colony in Jerusalem. And as you can guess by this picture, this is a sign that, he designed. These are rough times. The number of Jewish immigrants is increasing and the resources are limited. Living conditions are challenging and conflicts are developing with the Arab inhabitants. And even in 1948, when Israel is declared as a state, within less than a day, the war starts. So life, life's not simple. And in his book, there is one quote of a friend of him saying, I think he puts it very accurately when he says, it is very interesting to witness the birth of a state, but not recommended. And still, the exposure to the culture and atmosphere and appearance of Jerusalem affects David profoundly and inspires his work very much. He opens a studio and he works a lot. He gets many commissions from Jewish institutions and from the government. So these are posters, symbols of communication, documents for the temporary government, all those things, all those documents that you need when you start a new state, so coins, banknotes, stamps, and of course also commercial work. And most of his work is lettering, and it's bilingual, Hebrew and English, Hebrew and German. And you can see how he's not using any typefaces, and this is where he first comes across the shortage of Hebrew typefaces, for especially for continuous reading, and the lack of Hebrew typefaces family in particular. And these are stamps, they're really tiny and they're just beautiful. So if we want to imagine Ismar waking up in the morning and having his coffee and his cigar, and reading the newspaper, this is what it would look like, and I have to warn you before we're zooming in. So what would typesetters do when they have very limited physical metal typefaces, and they don't have different styles and things that we're used to for creating this differentiation within the text? So one thing would be increasing the space within the between the letters themselves and the sentences. The other would be using bigger type. This is, for instance, the names of the dates and the month that had to be more had to be emphasized, I'm guessing. And combining typefaces that are completely different, just to make this distinction in the typeface. And when he thinks back about the start of this project and this task that he puts to himself, he says, my dream was to enable every printer in the country to produce well-planned and well-organized printing for books and commerce, aesthetically comparable to printing with Roman type. And this, for me, started this whole diving into this area of the Roman type, of course, and trying to understand what are the differences and what is it that that Ismar wanted to be comparable with. So let me just briefly introduce you to the Hebrew. We have 27 letters. We read from right to left. Horizontal stress. We have five final forms, which means that they have, those letters have the same sound, but when they come at the end of the word, they have a different character. Five descenders, and four of them, again, are for the final forms, so they use rarely in comparison to the other letters, and only one descender. We have only one case, no uppercase or lowercase, and you see where I'm getting with this. So altogether, quite a squarish shape for all the letters. And just from a brief look to compare it with the Latin, you can see how the letters look very much like one another. And this has to do with the development of the Hebrew script. And the fact that the modern Hebrew letter developed from the Aramaic or Assyrian alphabet around the 6th century BCE. It was the language of the Israelites and the Judean people when around 200 BCE he died in the spoken language and was restricted to religious practice. It was only reintroduced as a spoken language around the 1880s. So what we have here is a long period of time where Hebrew is only read and copied. Nobody speaks it, nobody uses it on a day-to-day basis, and the scribes were authorized to write in Hebrew, would be copying religious and biblical texts, but they would not be allowed to change the shape of the letters, because the shape itself is divine, it is holy, the script is sacred, and nobody is allowed to change it, even at the cost of readability. And this is how the shape of the letter forms was fixed and didn't undergo this natural evolution that the secular script would undergo, for example, like the Latin script. And you can imagine the shift from written form to movable type from this point. So early punch cutters had no clear model, and most of them didn't know Hebrew. They weren't familiar with the script at all. And they just copied shapes from existing manuscripts that were usually of poor readability already. And while there was a period of some prosperity in the 15th century in Europe for Hebrew type, it didn't last long. And the Jewish people suffered persecution and were often forced to flee and relocate their presses. And that again prevented the continuous natural development that is needed for the refinement of type. And and eventually this leads for the shortage in Hebrew type up until today. So you can imagine how excited I was to see this image for the first time. This is from the book The Work of Ismar David that has all of his samples of all of his work. And when I opened this spread, I seriously could not believe my eyes. I asked for my friend to pinch me to make sure I'm not hallucinating, because there in front of my eyes was a comprehensive typeface family with three styles and three weights. And I know, you know, I'm setting type in Hebrew, and I have to go through those typographic acrobatics at times to make those differentiation and to make the text more user-friendly in Hebrew. And I didn't know that these tools ever existed. So that was the starting point of my research, and I have to share with you that, as you can imagine, the archives of Ismar David are enormous. There are piles of folders and boxes and many, many materials, but most of them, if not none of them, not all of them, are dated, titled, or annotated, and this is quite a frustrating situation to kind of conduct your research. However, it's very exciting, you know, I get to put my detective hat on and just look for as many things as I can and dig up more information and come up with educated guesses. And it's important for me to share this with you because this is an ongoing research and I'm still looking to validate some of the things that I think I see. And I hope to get more information. Okay, so let's zoom in and talk about the design itself. And let's talk about the situation that Ismar was dealing with in the 30s in Jerusalem, and what typesetters actually had. So we're talking about mainly two typefaces that were made in Europe, and was very much influenced by the fact that they were made there. The top one is related to the Mluba typeface, this specific one we don't know, and the bottom one is Frankish. And I want to emphasize the problems with this particular typefaces. So if you can look at the Resh, this Hebrew letter, you can see how much it's influenced from the Gothic style that was very popular then. And how the contrast is very, very big. And since we have horizontal stress, look at the leg of the letter and how thin it is, and how it makes all this this letter form look very unstable and fragile. And moreover, this thin line sometimes wouldn't print at all. Mm. So the letter would just disappear. In 1910, the Frankfurter typeface is being published, and although it's considerable improvement as far as readability goes, it still has its own shortcomings. So first of all, the contrast is a bit smaller, which is good, but this typeface was very much influenced by Eugène Schill and Art Nouveau, and is very much decorative, and when used in small sizes, it would create a very dark texture on the page. So again, more challenging to read. And what Ismar is doing is not trying to fix this, but deciding to have a completely different starting point, which is to go back and research and investigate and understand Hebrew letter from its origins and learn from it. And there is something with his calligraphy books that when he shares his philosophy about writing, and he says, well, this is summing it up, but he basically says he studies the letter forms, he understands them, and then he makes them his own. And this is a philosophy, and I think you will see this with this design process as well. So what I'm showing you here is a segment from the Dead Sea Scrolls. This is one of a list of archaeological findings that were discovered in Israel around the time that David was working on the typeface family, so it's fair to assume that he came across these materials. And because the shape of the letter forms was fixed, I can read what's written here. And I chose one word, and I want to show you. So the top word is from the scrolls, and the bottom word is David Hebrew. And I want to show you how the shapes correspond with the original writing of the Hebrew. And to compare it with the Frankfurt, which was, once it was out, it became very popular, and it still is very popular in Israel for Hebrew readers. Most of them are most familiar with this typeface. And look at the in-strokes in Hebrew, they're called tags. And look how different they look, and how decorative they are for the Frankfurt, and with the David Hebrew, how they correspond with the reed pen and with this movement to the right. And on top of that, look how Ismar David is introducing variety to those letter shapes that are very similar to one another. And instead of what's happening with the Frankfurt, on top of just using the same shape of the tags across all the letters, we can see in the David Hebrew the actual movement of the writing and how this varies the shape of the in-strokes. Of course, the contrast is much smaller, it's almost monolinear, even if it's not. The other problem, as you can guess, that we have in Hebrew, on top of the fact that all the letters are pretty much similar to another, we have specific couples or groups of two or three letters that are extremely similar to one another. And this is a sentence out of a book that was printed in 1476 in Italy. And these are two different letters. Yes. So again, they're on top, David Hebrew is at the bottom. And you can see those areas where he puts this completely different treatment in order to differentiate between the letters, when in the Frankfurt on top you can see it's pretty close. It feels like the strokes just, you know, going to the side. While in David Hebrew, there's this diagonal line and this kind of movement back and forth in the bed.
Okay.
My personal favorite, the italic style. This is something that is still considered very rare. There are typefaces that are slanted in Hebrew. There's a big discussion which direction they should be slanted to, the right or the left. We won't get into that now. But because the type and typography didn't evolve, didn't have the time and the luxury to evolve, this notion of an italic typeface never developed. And that didn't stop Ismail David. And I think that what he did here was to go back and explore the calligraphic hands that we have in Hebrew. So to the right, we have the formal square hand, which very much influenced most of the typefaces. In the middle, there's the semi-cursive style, which is actually a secondary style. It was used for commentary in religious text. And the last one is an informal cursive, which was, you know, fast writing for daily needs. And they were very distant from one another, so they were strictly separated because the two hands were related to writing biblical text, and the informal was something that was completely out of the picture, so they couldn't really inform one another. This is an example for the formal and semi-cursive together. So the main text would be in the middle or bigger or at one area of the page, and the semi-cursive or Ktav Rashi, as we call it in Hebrew, would be next to it and would signify a different meaning. So this is the commentary, it's not the main text. So what I think happened after I studied the letter form of all the styles of the family is that you can see the bet in the regular style. In the middle is the semi-cursive style, and then there is the bet of the italic style. And I think you can really feel this morph into this new shape and where it came from. And as another reference is this informal style with all those loops. So it is a fast, this is a hand that writes faster, and the pen wouldn't leave as much the surface and creates those very interesting loops. And I think this is what may have happened again with this designing of this new letter form that is combining all of this information into one letter. And the last style, the monolinear. Again, I think we can see the correspondence with those inscriptions and mosaics in Hebrew. And of course, there were many, many, many sketches. We don't have many of them. The ones we do are, again, undated and titled, so a lot of guessing is going on there. And not very much to say, perhaps, apart from the fact that we know that they were all designed simultaneously. So again, this concept of designing a typeface family, which is one system that all the styles and the weights share the same proportions. This is at least one thing that we can say about these sketches. And another wonderful part of this process is that it took 2 decades from when Ismail David started the design process until it was actually produced. Again, rough time, there was war, another war in the middle, and it was produced in New York. And during that time, Ismail David doesn't keep his sketches in the drawer. he realizes that most of his readership is used to those typefaces that I've shown you before, and he is creating something quite innovative, and he tests it. So in his commercial work, he's pasting up his new design as if they were type, and releases this to the to his audiences, and he says that the reactions were good. So that's another fascinating phase in this process. And as I said, in 1954, the type is being produced with Intertype in New York. Only the regular style and the italic style at 12 point. That's it. And when it comes to Israel, it's becoming very, very, very popular. It creates those really beautiful, clear and light, very visible pages. I'm showing you the first complete book that was published in both the regular style and the italic style from 1960. This is another example of two styles together, and another one. But unfortunately, the italic style is being rejected by the local typesetters. Again, you can have many thoughts about why, but what we know is that the representative of Intertype wrote and asked specifically not to to produce more of the italic style, but have more weights and sizes instead. And so the italic style disappeared, even if it was there for a short time. And as I mentioned before, it's not, it's still until today, it's not a convention in Hebrew typography. And this is 1984, when the typeface is, David is adapting it to Stempel, and this particular proofs were very exciting for me to find, because they are actually annotated. You can see those little remarks, and they had to do with the vowel marks of the Hebrew that did not exist for the metal type and had to be redrawn and repositioned by Ismael David. And again, only the regular style in two ways. And then the inevitable happens. As we know, with many popular typefaces and fonts, they get new versions under the same name and under similar names. There is, I think, one version of David that was released in '82 and was called Duvid, for example. And I'm showing you one of many, but this is actually a version that I believe influenced very much the perception of the David Hebrew in Israel, because it was shipped with Microsoft Word in 1990, and it was the default typeface in Hebrew. And you can see the top Aleph is the original David Hebrew and the bottom one. But we have good news also. So in 2012, Monotype with cooperation with Helen Brandschaft, which worked closely with Ismael David and redrew the original letter forms and the drawing, and digitized the complete family. So it is now available to purchase if anyone is interested. And I still have to show you examples of contemporary typesetting in Israel, because the fact that the family is available doesn't mean that people are actually buying it and using it. And so we see recent examples of text differentiation, which are more or less the same as the beginning of the 1930s at least. So we can see wider spacing within the letters, different typefaces for the references, different weights for the reference up there. Different typefaces above the X height and an underline. So, and in 2016, the David Hebrew from the Monotype version is joining the Google Libra, the free fonts of Google, which is very, it's a very good thing. not the italic force in the sense, only the regular with free weights, so it's out there. And to finish on a, again, an optimistic note, I want to share with you another very exciting moment that I had in Reading University, in the reading room, when I came across this book, which is in itself fascinating. It's about Hebrew typography in German-speaking regions. And this book is trilingual, so it's in English, in German, and in Hebrew. And I opened it from the Latin side, so left to right. And I looked at the typesetting for the German and for the English. I can't remember specifically what the typefaces were, but they had the regular style and the italic style. And as I was flipping the book, I was very nervous because I was very curious to see how the typesetter dealt with this another component to the same book with a typeface that doesn't have traditionally authentic italic. And what they did was use the David Hebrew, both for the headlines and regular for the main text, and the italic for word differentiation. And I was very happy and I enjoyed reading this very much. And I think this is about it. I hope you can agree that part of David's process was to learn the letter form, understand them, and make it your own. And I hope this inspires you as much as it did. That as much as it inspired me. Thank you very much.
I know.
Yes.
You're talking about the argument between the, it says a slant to the left, a slant to the right. I think that Ismar was more persuasive about slanting to the right, and I'll tell you why.
Mm-hmm.
When he would write the mem,
mm-hmm.
and the thing is that the mem would normally be put it round, and the thing is it bounces, it moves to the left,
mm-hmm.
and that's part of the sort of the motion of the pen, and the
yes.
motion of the hand. So you go dum-de-doom,
mm-hmm.
and you don't do that when you do the final forms. They're very square, they go down,
yes.
they're vertical.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm kind of surprised that he leans the italic to the
To the left.
Yes. So, do you think there's drawings anywhere of him move the other way?
I think there is. I need to verify a few things about that particular sketch. So once I do that, then I feel comfortable enough. I will. I will tell everyone about it, of course. This is again a fascinating debate, and it's ongoing, and I don't think it'll ever go away.
That's good.
But from what I learned so far, so there's two competitors, let's say, versions that say, first of all, what you just said, that the tendency of the writing, the fast writing in Hebrew would be to the right. And therefore, just like you said, you know, when you write with your right hand, if you're not left-handed, then most of the people would have that tendency to the right. Another thing that that you can think about is the fact that, do you know how we have that, as soon as the desktop publishing came to be, there was this I button that would mechanically slant all of our typefaces. I think for the Hebrew, it was only to the right. I think that there wasn't an option to choose which way it mechanically slants, you know, you couldn't choose how to deform your letter, you just had one option. And that might have became a convention, people maybe got used to reading it like that. And if you look through the manuscript, you will find informal, even semi-cursive styles that are leaning to the right.
The Dead Sea Scroll showed that sort of to the left.
Yeah. However, and I love this quote, I think it's by, it's Vinon Keys. He said that if you slant it to the right, you're going against the direction of the reading. And it's like running backwards. So imagine just the process of reading. You're reading from right to left, and then when you hit the italic, it goes backwards. And I personally, I tend to agree with putting the reading direction over the writing direction.
So the title
specifically, specifically because again, this direction is not something that really evolved into something coherent or into some way, you know, some sort of a model. It was, you can find many places from all over the world, you know, the Jewish communities scattered all over, and their writings were influenced by the area they were living in. And, you know, this brings up a lot of variation. It doesn't necessarily mean that these are the things that would prove to be, good or work better for type. So there are different arguments, but sure, you know, we just need to make more. We just need to make more typefaces, and we don't test it for ourselves. That's my personal view.
Do you draw yourself? Do you draw typefaces? You've been at Reading. So.
I've been at Reading. I drew one typeface, and and then I saw this amazing work, and I just realized that I could never do it again.
Well, that's a good starting point. You might as well build on.
There are some designs, and I'm super excited about the research now, so I'm putting most of my energy there. But they are kind of making voices from the drawers, and they'll get my attention, I'm sure.
So the letters Hey, Chet, and Resh.
Yes.
If you're thinking of standardizing typography, are you approaching it from the same thing and saying, well, Hey comes first alphabetically, but a Resh is basically a Hey with the other line missing, and a Chet is basically a Hey with a complete line, or are you just saying, like, how are you approaching those letters that are so similar?
Yeah, so first of all, the writing, it has so much information when you just draw the letters and use different tools. See how that affects. And there are some things I can tell you, the resh and the chet and the taf, for instance, which are again very similar. What David did was take the sort of the second stroke of the taf and curve it slightly inwards, which is something that makes sense. You could use your tool to do that, and that would create this differentiation because it wouldn't be just the same letter, the chet, with another just added stroke. These are the challenges, and I think this is what makes this whole process so fascinating, because you have those boundaries. I guess in any type design, it's the same thing. But
those letters, and are very four very simple. Yeah, adding that exactly. Four very similar. Yeah.
So just, you know, trying to kind of find those little things that would actually put the emphasis on the things that have most common, you know, that the most similar, and then change the joints, then change an angle, think that would still make sense and that would still be authentic to the writing, but that would be the place where you put your input in. Yes.
I'm just wondering if you have any thoughts, any theories about why the italic was the semi cursive was rejected.
Nothing again that I feel very comfortable with. Talking about, I have some thoughts about the practicality of using, again, we have to kind of take ourselves back in history and in time and imagine the atmosphere and the fact that there was no time and no resources and that sometimes no paper or no ink. These are the kind of things that I'm thinking about and I'm trying to see how things became conventional or not. So maybe this was all of a sudden such a different shape or something that would kind of create more work for the typesetters. But then I think that you would still have to duplex with a bolder weight, and this is something we see quite a lot. So using differentiation with heavier weights rather than, you know, different styles. So I'm not quite sure about that.
do you think it's, is it possible that it's because it too closely mimics the Ketan Farashi in rabbinic texts that were published?
And then it felt more
traditional? They wanted to distance themselves from...
Perhaps, because this is again a very interesting point. So that was the time where the people in Israel were writing their new narrative. They were these new Jews, the Zionists, and they did everything they could to detach themselves from everything that was old and traditional and biblical. And that was a part of, I think, what made David Hebrew so popular. It was modern. It was something that didn't look like the Meruba and those Gothic typefaces that they would see in Bibles. So that had a lot to do again with. So maybe what you're suggesting is actually the correlation with the religious commentary is not something that they wanted to, perhaps.
So he published a book about calligraphy, and that was that after the Dead Sea Scrolls.
Yes.
So the type design work that he did that resulted in the David Hebrew typeface.
Yeah.
Did he document that kind of like script logic and design thinking that translated the calligraphy into the type?
No.
because the Microsoft version obviously doesn't understand the essence of the design, and it has this kind of, like, the shapes are in roughly the right place, but the stroke logic is completely missing.
Exactly. I can tell you this before I went to work in the archives. Now in this fellowship, I knew that I'm going to go through his personal libraries and his personal book collection. And I dreamt at night that I'm finding, this booklet or article in the newspaper with just, something that says David was here. I couldn't find any of that. But I can tell you that I was looking at his Hebrew workshop materials. So both the writing, preparing, introducing himself to the class and talking generally about what they're about to learn, and both, and also we have rolls of a brown craft paper that he would use to hang on the wall and then draw the letters, and he puts a lot of emphasis about the transition from old Hebrew to new Hebrew. So you can see on the top line there would be the old shapes that are much more they have much more variations, by the way. In a sense, we kind of move backwards if you look at the squares that came afterwards. But so we had that in the top row. Another version of the Hebrew at the middle, and the Hebrew that you know, or even something that looks very monolinear, very modern. And I read from his description that he goes letter by letter and talks about how those forms were created. So he was researching this topic a lot, and when he writes later on about how he approached this whole project, he specifically talks about saving the Hebrew type from the bad treatment that it got in Europe departed, from the original forms. So I have nothing, to prove you, but I think we can see that. Yes.
So continuing on the Microsoft version, it has flaws that are very common when designers are not proficient in a certain writing system. It's very common in Hebrew typefaces currently, or released by Adobe. That's, I think, it has like very visible, like it's kind of like color by numbers, where if you're struggling, you don't understand the writing system and the hand gestures. So it's pretty like evident in those versions.
Arial Hebrew is probably like, what?
But you know, there is an interesting phenomenon that happens now with new Hebrew typefaces that they use the Latin stress. I don't know if you've seen this. And this is interesting because it's very, very popular. People love it, they use it a lot. And
that's
it has like.
That's got to be display typography. It can't be texting. That was 3,000 years of tradition.
Did this one David write about the other versions?
No.
He never publicly commented on it?
No.
About the what?
The other versions, like Microsoft.
Yeah.
He
didn't write. So the only things that we have that he actually wrote was either letters that were written to him and he replied, so people from Israel, people that were inquiring him specifically about his time. And there was an event that the typophiles were doing for him. It was called Ismar David Day. And, it was in 74, and he wrote a speech. So we have the drafts for the speech, and there he goes through his describing the process. I haven't found yet more than these snippets of things. Maybe they're out there, and I certainly hope so.
So I don't know. Can I ask a more general question? So since this very productive period in the middle of the last century, when you have David and Hadassah and Quran all around the same kind of window of time, how has the situation changed, or has it really changed up till today in terms of typefaces for continuous reading?
It's a very good question. That's frustrating because things take time. So we have new typefaces and more independent type foundries that are coming up, and I think very popular. So they're very, speaking with the audience and designers, buy them and use them, and you can see them. You can see new things.
But also in book typography.
Yes.
Okay.
I don't know. I don't know if the book typography, let's say like this, when we design in Latin, we make sure to do this distinction between the book typeface and display typeface. I might be wrong, and I haven't been in Israel for quite a while, but I don't think that there is such a, there would be, this is a display typeface. But when you go down to the details.
Right, there's the distinction between like a book typeface and a newspaper typeface.
Yeah, and you can, but again, I might not be updated. I think that the thing that I did notice is, and it maybe doesn't mean a thing, but some of us use the names of the styles and weights, so book or regular or display within the family to kind of, as a tool for the user to kind of suggest this was designed for the headline, this was designed for a page, and so on and so forth. I don't think I've encountered a Hebrew typeface family that has those specification within the name. That might be a different issue altogether, but I'm just trying to kind of think how to best answer these questions, and very little true italics. But I think things might be starting to wake up, which is great. Yes?
On the italics, I mean, really, there's a huge history of cursive. Could somebody do that? What is the problem? Come on,
I'll
guys.
Tell you what the problem is. If you know Liron Levy Tukenich, she's a colleague of mine, and she also deals very deeply with this subject. And in her last talk, I think she gave this brilliant description of what's happening today with Hebrew typography, and she called it the vicious circle. And this is exactly how things look like. So italic is not a convention in Hebrew typography. So typesetters are not looking for it, so they won't be buying it, so type designers are not designing it because nobody would buy them. And this is something that feels, you know, stronger than us, because who would go and add another style and an Italic to his family when he knows that he would be working on it, you know, for years and nobody.
Yeah, okay.
I'm hoping this could change, and I'm hoping, you know, we'll have some even charity work or whatever. And again, you know, it makes you think. How does a typographic convention even happens? How do you introduce something in that doesn't have this this long tradition of this slow evolution? You know, it may sound not very nice, but I often describe things that I see in Hebrew type or design as sketches. And if you think about it, essentially this is what they are. We didn't have this luxury of time and sources for this, you know, field to be developed when you compare it to the Latin, let's put it, you know, like this. Because, for example, if you look, so the Hebrew was asleep, I don't like calling it dead for that portion of time, because if you look closely, you can see how scribes did deal with the fact that they wanted their Bibles to look nicer, be more expensive, you know, make more money out of them, be more distinguished. And you can see some sort of evolution in evolution happens there within the constraints of this holy forms. But all of that didn't happen for the language that we speak today. You can even feel it with the language itself, with the vocabulary that we have in Hebrew. It just, you know, once you start thinking about it, it's a very deep hole. It doesn't end, but it's fascinating. And maybe the Hebrew doesn't need an italic.
Well,
it needs something else.
Too.
I don't know.
English doesn't need an italic.
Maybe.
Roman type doesn't need an italic. We could space it out like everybody else in the world.
I think it would take much longer to read. I don't know, maybe it's my personal
slow
thought, but when you have slow spaces, I always kind of go, why are you stopping me? I'm in the middle of reading this, and all of a sudden you have one. Yes.
Did you speak with Helen Franca? You mentioned her.
Yes, so she's been amazing through all the period that I was writing my thesis and afterwards, because I never stopped researching. And during the month that I was in Rochester, we were emailing one another daily. I was taking pictures, she was telling me this, she was telling me that. And I'm working with her also for the time that I'm here. And there's so much work. There's so many more things to see and to think about and to kind of, you know, try to learn more. And super exciting. Yes.
I had a question about the monolinear style.
Yeah.
Because it seems like if he was looking back to old styles of Hebrew calligraphy and lettering, that even something like the Dead Sea Scrolls could inform a non-monolinear
yes
style, and it seems visionary, or like sort of like what's still happening today of being in the process of discovering new ways to express Hebrew. Was that something that was embraced by people? Do they know what to do with it? Was it ever used widely?
No. Again, many questions that I wish I had the answers to. What we know is that he didn't produce it with the intertype. So we can speculate in, you know, many things. Maybe he wasn't pleased with it, maybe they couldn't afford it, I don't know. But the fact is that he was never, and he actually writes about it kind of regrettably, because his dream was to have a type family that is comparable with Roman type, meaning a sans serif equivalent. That never came out to the public. I can tell you that I think that I found later versions of this style, which is, again, amazing. I think that the proportions are the same, but the strokes are more calligraphic, and maybe you can assume that he wasn't either finished or pleased or just continuing his work. But there's more version of it. And in my personal opinion, I think, and you described it very well, it feels like the odd one out. It has this really strange appearance to it. I haven't seen it, I've seen it in proofs and in specimens for text, and it would be, to my opinion and taste, more of a display or something like more have a different voice to it. But I've seen versions of this for stone inscriptions in Hebrew, and they are amazing. This is just, you know, it's fascinating to see, you know, those old, the echo of the old forms with those inscriptions translated into something modern and very readable and very beautiful. So I hope Kevin answers the question.
And to know that he was designing architectural things too.
Yes.
Seems really nice.
It's, yeah. This is like my next thing on my list. So the Brotherhood Synagogue here in New York City and the Pylon in Long Island, which is the whole memorial park, but it pretty much did everything there. So, looking forward to that.
Thank you so much.
Wow.
Thank you.